Hi, I'm Peter Birch. Today we're going to look at different ways to incubate reptile eggs. Welcome to CrittaCam. Now, with artificial incubation, there are quite a few different ways to do it. There's the old method of medium. So basically, you use a medium, whether it be perlite, vermiculite, or even a product just like this, which is the Rapashi Super Hatch, which is pretty exciting. It's just hit Australia and some really good results overseas. So it'd be good to see what this is going to do for the Australian hobbyists. So basically, with the medium method, you add water, whether it be 1:1 or until the medium actually changes colour, and then you place the eggs directly on top of the medium like such. And then basically, you know, you encapsulate the eggs, allowing the humidity inside there to basically roll around and give them the ideal amount of humidity. Or the other way is what they call suspended method way, which is just like this. So we're using the same tub as we use for the medium, and basically you just have water on the bottom on here, and you place the rack on top. So the idea of this method is to allow the eggs to be separated from directly from the water, because too much water in the egg will actually cause the embryos to drown, allowing them once again to be encapsulated inside there to get the right amount of humidity and moisture flowing around. Now obviously the eggs aren't going to take on too much moisture and cause them to erupt. They're going to take on exactly the right amount of moisture they need to be able to go the full distance. Now, you can actually use a combination of both as well. So that's something that's a little bit different. So there again, you have the water method. Sorry, you have the water method here with the THG tubs, very efficient tubs. You just have the water on the bottom, you have your rack on top, or you can actually use the medium, whether it be perlite, vermiculite, or in this case, super hatch, and you can place the rack on top just like that, place your eggs inside there, and put the lid on top. Now, what's the benefit of doing this way? Well, as you can see, water does move around a bit. You could use water gel, but to get the right amount of moisture out of the water gel, you need to have it really wet. So basically, it's almost just as viscous as water, very moving around. So the theory is, if you're using the water method and you're moving eggs, you could splash the bottom of the eggs, get them wet, and of course, allow the embryo to drown. If you're using medium, well, you can see, you can splash it around, it's not going to do anything. And if you drop it on the ground, well, regardless of what method you're using, medium, suspended method with medium, the eggs are doomed. So there's three very inventive ways to be able to, you know, artificially incubate your eggs. There's so many different ways you can do it, or different options. You've got the sim tubs, very good tubs. I mean, I like these, they're very clear. They've got a nice clear rack. They've got this little area that holds it above the water, or medium there. Place your eggs in time. That's the big sim. Here's the small sim. Crystal clear. So easy to see what's going on. And I mean, we've got a few eggs cooking at the moment. So we can have a bit of a look at the different techniques that I'm sort of using. Why do I prefer one method over another? I don't know. I can't explain. It's not a preferred method. Sometimes I'll try something different. Like last year, I used a lot of water gel. This year, I'm not using any water gel at all. I'm using a little bit of this super hatch stuff because I think it's going to be pretty cool, especially for the geckos and some of the dragon eggs. So we'll have a look around and check them out. I guess the other important thing about artificial incubation is the actual incubator itself. There's two pretty cool things you need to be reminded about. Number one, make sure the tubs that you're using fit inside the incubator. And number two, I've never ceased to be amazed by the fact that people will cut corners when it comes to an incubator. They'll always try and make their own incubator for a couple of $100s and then hope to put their investment quality animals, which could be a couple of $1,000s worth of eggs, inside that incubator and hope to get great results. Not saying that it doesn't happen, but more often you have more failures than success. I mean, for a very small investment for an incubator just like this, it's a small incubator. These things are commercially worth about $1,500 inside the incubator. I've used for many years and produced many good clutches of awesome creatures. And I mean, going from this to the next size is only a matter of growth and reproduction. We're always having some great seasons here at my facility. And once again, we've got another bumper year. So we had to turn off the small incubator and go to the big one. Let's check it out. We're here inside my walk-in incubator. Some people would say it's a little bit over the top, but it's exactly what I need to be able to hatch my beautiful little babies. I mean, a few of the cool things you need in here, obviously, is a well sought out shelf and a heating system. The heat needs to be consistent, so therefore the temperature that these top eggs get and the eggs on the bottom row get the same temperature zones. There's no good having half a degree difference in between each shelf. For me, that's no good at all. I like to make sure that the temperatures are nice and consistent. The other really cool thing, I think, it doesn't matter how hot the room temperature is. The most important thing for me is the temperature inside the box. So I've got a probe set up inside a box, which tells me exactly the temperature, the air temperature inside the box. That's the most important key for myself. I mean, we're using some medium here. We've got a lot of suspended over water. Like I said, I did use crystals, but I went away from it. I didn't find the results were really that good. I'm also using a lot of the THD tubs. I find them great for the geckos and some of the small stuff. I've got some monitor eggs over here on basically perlite underneath. So I'm using medium and suspended method. So different techniques for different things. Is there a reason why? I'm not really sure, to be honest. But I'll tell you what, when you're getting results just like these little beauties here, these guys are only just hatched. Look at these gorgeous little things. That's a T-positive children's python. Absolutely gorgeous, quite a few in this clutch. Now, the other method of incubation that a lot of people don't really try is called maternal incubation, where you leave the eggs with the mother and let her do all the hard work. But more importantly, you guys could learn something very important by watching these creatures do exactly what they do. And just luckily enough, I've got a couple of girls still sitting on eggs. I'm allowing them to maternally incubate. I'm allowing them to maternally incubate, just like I have done for a few years, and then that way I can learn so much more about these beautiful creatures. I find it quite fascinating watching these beautiful girls maternally incubate their own eggs. And yes, I do artificially incubate quite a few of my eggs, but occasionally, a few times a year, I let a few of these girls sit on their eggs, just so I can learn some more about the wonderful behaviour, how they sit and coil around those eggs and keep those eggs so nice and safe. And this particular girl sitting here is one of my favorites. She's 19 years old, that's right, 19 years old, and still producing great clutches of fertile eggs. I mean, look at this beautiful girl sitting there, doing exactly what she's meant to do, protect those eggs. Now, one of the most interesting things for myself, watching these animals maternally incubate their eggs, is the choice of nesting site. Now, a lot of people speculate exactly where they'd like to pick and choose. Now, these two tubs both have females sitting on eggs. This female's chosen to sit in the front corner of the tub, which is the coldest place in this whole environment. This female in this tub has actually chosen to sit towards the back on top of the heat. Why they've chosen these two different areas, and they're exactly the same creatures. They're the Antaresia maculosa, the spotted pythons, one of my favorite species to work with. Why they've chosen two different places to pick, to lay their eggs and actually maternally incubate them, I don't know. Now, a lot of people actually speculate that they need to be a certain type of moisture levels and all this sort of thing. I mean, this girl sitting here at the front, she's got a little bit of sphagnum moss around there. It's not really moist, it's quite dry. The eggs actually have this leathery shell. They'll dry up a bit, look a little bit shriveled, a little bit gross. There's actually a couple of bad eggs in there as well. I've chosen to leave them in there, because from my experience, mum always knows best. She'll just sit on those eggs, hold them there until the babies start to move, and let mum know that she's getting close to when the babies are gonna pip and come out. Now, when we maternally incubate them, we can get them to hatch around about 45 to 50 days. When they're maternally incubating, we're looking at about 60 to 65 days. Is that better or is it worse? I believe it's better. It's a more natural way for the female to be able to incubate and cook those eggs really nice. The other cool thing is, when the females are like this, they will still eat, and I'll show you right now how they do that. Now, the whole idea is, when I feed these girls sitting on eggs, is not to feed them something really big. So I give them a decent sized meal, but not too big. Hey, baby. And as you can see, the female's doing a little bit of twitching there. She's getting a little bit defensive. She doesn't really know what's going on, but she knows it's food. And as you can see, she'll do exactly what a normal snake would do, whether she's on eggs or not. She wraps her prey up and she'll start to eat it. That's going to show us right now.
clutch of eggs sitting in there. I'm just going to let her do her thing.
So we're going to offer this girl up the top here a feed. She's not as well mannered as the one down below. And in fact, she's already coming out to see what's going on. This girl here is a little bit more voracious, I'd like to call it, when it comes to food. So she'll actually come a bit further off her eggs. So we'll bring her out a bit more before we let her take her food. Here we go. Good mama. And there you go. Isn't nature wonderful? Well, I don't know about you guys, whether it be artificial incubation or maternal incubating. I prefer maternal incubating. I can learn so much from these beautiful creatures. I hope you enjoyed this week's show. Make sure you hit us up on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Until next time, thanks for watching CrittaCam.